research. For starters, we have, as Eric mentioned, limited information on ice hockey. There is, if we look through the scientific literature, we can see that mostly it's profiling of players, how their oxygen uptakes are, how much they can do with bench press, and how high they can jump, and what their body fat content is. And that's basically what it is. And then there is some limited research on people using simulated models. Nobody had actually looked at ice hockey before. Earlier today, I spoke about peak periods in football, and my personal interest in ice hockey is those peak periods, because in ice hockey, you only do peak periods. Most of the players, not all, but most of them. And I will show you mainly from a sports science approach is the limited research, but also from an exercise physiology point of view, it is interesting because this is a way to study repeated high intensity exercise in a natural setting. So that's why we are looking at this sport. And Eric's PhD program is primarily technical and tactical orientated, and the physical data that he will use in the data in the studies will only be to explain the other variables and to look at interconnections between those. So more or less down the line that Paul told us earlier. So ice hockey is also interesting because in earlier today I said that we are studying muscle physiology, but what happens to upper body muscles? And this is something that we have started to investigate also, that in Dan's PhD program we saw that muscles, they fatigue, but they fatigue differently. And sometimes if we only look through scientific literature and we solely look at what happens in the thigh muscles, we limit ourselves. So from a research point of view, we also have these aspects. So I will start with some physiology. And this is a study that was published by Jaya, a good friend of mine. He's now the coach of Inter Milan, fitness coach of Inter Milan. He was former fitness coach for Man United. And he did this very nice study where people, they did a lot of cycling at different intensities. So they did how long can they do 100 watts, 200 watts, 300, 600, 700. All of the performances, and we can see this nice curve here that the harder you work, the less time you can work until you are fatiguing. And then they did a lot of profiling, and they looked at height and body mass and every wheel to max and peak power and fiber types and capillaries and a lot of those muscle variables that we know are important for performance. So they said, what is important for endurance performance? What is important for high intensity performance? And if we look at the physiological response, if you do 30 seconds of all-out exercise or 3 minutes of all-out exercise, and you looked at the changes in pH in the blood, but most importantly in the muscle, you see that these values are much lower than if you work for 2 hours. So clearly you are tasking different physiological systems when you are doing all-out exercise at a high intensity compared to a low intensity. So it's not, doesn't matter what you do. If you want to train, you need to have a high intensity, especially when we have high intensity sports such as football, handball, and ice hockey especially. So if we're looking at about physiological predictors for performances that are lasting half a minute to maybe 1 minute, which would be specific for ice hockey, it's capillary density, it's the number of sodium potassium pumps. So we have some physiological markers for that type of performance. So that's an interesting point of view, and we have a planned project that we hope to obtain funding for at the University of Aarhus and in collaboration with the University of Gothenburg, where we're trying to study some of those physiological mechanisms behind ice hockey performance. But that's not the topic today. That was just an advertisement for some of you. So this is Eric's first paper, and this is basically what I'm going to present. The only thing that I'm going to present now because of lack of data. We're trying now to obtain more data on what ice hockey is, objectively speaking, because we don't know. Nobody has ever precisely validated methods showed those types of data that we have in football, for example. So basically, from a match analyzing point of view, we're back to Tom Riley, 1976, when it comes to ice hockey. So, but we want to improve this. We should. Do you agree on that, that we should improve our knowledge of ice hockey? Yes? We have one. At least one of you thinks that that's a good idea. So, let's do that. So we had this team of ice hockey players. This is a Canadian team, Vancouver Canucks, which is a good team, internationally speaking. So we have typical age for world-class athletes, 28 on average. They are relatively tall, these players, and compared to football players, they are a little heavier. They have relatively low body fats. So compared to their weight, they have actually quite high oxygen uptakes. And they are explosive, really well-trained athletes. So this was the group that we had, and then we had this difficult question, and maybe we have done it the correct way, most likely we have done it the wrong way, and we will learn in a few years. But what we do today, like Paul said, we will be very critical in a few years. But we have to set these limitations somewhere, and if we look at the total skating, was everything that was faster than 1 kilometer per hour. So based on that, on average they skate 4.6 kilometers in the game of ice hockey. Then we have slow and very slow and slow, moderate, fast, very fast, and sprint skating, which was actually faster than 24 kilometers per hour. So if we look at the distribution of the high intense categories, these values are much higher if we take into account the playing time, the time on ice, which is short compared to other sports. So ice hockey is a much faster game than the other team sports, but it has some similarities if we take those peak periods in the other sports into account. Then we did some of the traditional things that have been done in other sports. Obviously, if you remember Eric's presentation, he showed some of the technical data and he showed large differences between forwards and defenders. The same thing is when we look at the globally over a game, the distance covered. Here we haven't taken into account the playing time, but if you just look at how much they do, we can see that the forwards, they have a more intense profile than the defenders on average. And looking at the slow categories, we can see that the defensemen are doing more skating in total, but less when it comes to the high intensity training areas. Then we try to look at accumulated fatigue, which is difficult, or signs of fatigue, or performance decrement, which is maybe a better term to use. And we have the four periods here, period 1, 2, 3, and 4. And it's the fourth period because it was a draw. And if we look at high intensity skating and we express data in meters per minute, we can see that they are actually doing most work in period 3. So from a traditional point of view, we would say that they are not fatiguing. But if we look at the average sprint skating speed in kilometers per hour, how fast are they actually skating on average? We can see that skating speed is lower in period 3 and 4 compared to the first two, so maybe there are some type of performance decrement in relation to the most intense skating bouts, which, without any knowledge of ice hockey at all, I would suppose are important. If those actions that we saw before, we saw that the player was shooting from the blue line, and then we saw that, as Eric said, that it was important that a player would pick up the ball. The one of the two in the front, he's skating out to the left side. You remember that situation? So if you are skating slower at that period, you won't be able to reach the ball compared to the fast player. So those types of actions appear to be compromised. Then we said, can we try to test physiological capacity of players? And When we're testing athletes, we should test them in their natural environment. So if you want to test ice hockey players, you should test them on the ice. So we did the yo-yo test, the yo-yo intermittent recovery test level number one. And we did a sub-maximum version of the test because as this was a world-class team, and as Eric says, ice hockey players, they play all the time. They play much more than compared to handball and football, so that we were not allowed to test them with an exhaustive test. So we did a sub-maximum version where they tested, where they skated for 6 minutes into the test, and we measured the heart rate and we expressed it as percentages of the maximum heart rate. And we actually found some correlations that resembles those correlations that we see in football. That if you are taxed highly after intermittent skating on the ice, then you have lower values when we look at very fast skating, high intensity skating, and the number of high intensity skating bouts. Compared to if this is easy for you, if you are below 70%, which some of the players were, these two guys are actually Swedes. Two Swedish twins were the best, the fittest players in the team. And they were also the players that are doing the most. So we saw some correlations between physical capacity in the testing regime on the ice and what goes on in the game. So actually we have validated this test as a test that you can use in ice hockey. And this is what you can use match analysis for as well, to find out which testing regimes are good. Like the reactive speed test that Paul showed you, shows a high correlation to what goes on in the game, but you perform it in a controlled setting. So it's an objective measurement, standardized condition. Then we also took some blood samples, we're not going to talk about those today, but then we come to the individual variations that we have highlighted in handball today, and also in football. Are there any individual variations in the game of ice hockey? And if we just have this figure here showing the total distance covered, we can see that some of the players are close to 8 kilometers in a game, while some of them are down to 2 kilometers, mainly because of the playing time. We see the same variations when we express data in relation to meters per minute, and we have variations in high intensity skating, huge variations between the individual players. So again, we have this issue in ice hockey that we have shown with basketball and rugby and any other team sports that we have. We need to be more individualized, and this is what match analyzing approaches can help us to do. Here are some of those players, and this is the average values. This is sprint skating. This is where the players are, and we can see that this Finnish guy here is down here because this is a fantastic player, fantastic defender, but he has a very strong tactical capacity, which makes him most of the most valuable players in the team, but he's not working that hard. Compared to this attacker here, or forward, who's extremely hardworking. So, the discussion, what is most important, the technical or the tactical or the physical? Nothing is more important. Everything is important. But for this guy here, the physical dimension may be less important than for this guy here. If we don't measure these things, we won't know. We can't spot those players we can't have an objective opinion about what is the key performance indicators, what makes this player valuable for us in the team. And if we take those Boot and Salah as examples, this is the hardworking player, this is the clever player. Two different profiles when we look at the sprints, the number of sprints, the speed that they reach, and also when we look at the distance that they are covered. This guy here, really long, and somebody is wondering why is this sprint longer than the ice rink? This is why you can't sprint. You can't do a curved sprint. Okay? Good. So, this is the first study in ice hockey showing what ice hockey is from a physical point of view. And it will be fantastic now that we will have some measurements on the technical and the tactical analysis that Eric is working on. And it will be even more compelling.